Welcome back to the DC New 52 Review. I want to thank you for tuning into this episode. I am your host as always, Pauly DC, and let's get into another one of these things. Today, I will discuss Wonder Woman Volume 1. It was titled Blood, and it was written by Brian Azzarello with art by Cliff Chang and Tony Akins, with the first six issues being released between November 2011 to April of 2012. Wonder Woman, or Princess Diana of Themyscira, is among a handful of DC characters I really don't even need to give a big intro on. She's the company's number one lady and hands down the most recognizable female in all of superhero comics, having been created in All-Star Comics number 8, October 1941 by William Moulton Marston and H.G. Peter. Her origin has always been tied to Greek mythology, having been the daughter to Amazonian queen Hippolyta, and this series featured many mythological storylines, which was very exciting for me. Of course, in the New 52, she became one of the Justice League's Big Three, gained some new family here, and started a relationship with someone that vexed a lot of people. But that is something we'll have to wait for Justice League Volume 2 to see for the first time. Issue number 1 begins in Singapore with Apollo, the sun god, not to be confused with Helios, who is the sun personified in Greek myth, speaking to three ladies regarding the whereabouts of his missing father, aka Zeus, and then uses them as pretty much oracles that tell him one of his father's children will kill a sibling and take their place. The most telling info then follows, saying that Zeus doesn't exist at the moment yet. So Apollo has what he needs and burns the ladies away. Cutting to Virginia, USA next, the Queen of Olympus, Hera, is lurking around a barn, finding a scythe to be used for the beheadings of two horses, which can then regrow with something new. Back to that in a minute, because inside a farmhouse, a World War I looking Hermes, the messenger of the gods among other things, is arguing with a young lady named Zola, telling her she is in a lot of danger, which has now arrived first with Hermes taking an arrow to the chest, thanks to a duo of evil centaurs that Hera has now created. Zola is saved by Hermes thanks to a teleportation key whisking her away to London, more specifically the bedroom of a sleeping Wonder Woman. I can sense some of your thoughts after me saying that. Bad. Bad. Zola awakens Diana, who seems rather unfazed by this whole occurrence, immediately revealing that she's Wonder Woman and asking for Hermes' key, but allows herself to be trick-teleported back to Virginia instead. Once the two girls are there, they hear Hermes shouting in pain right before Wonder Woman has to defend Zola from oncoming arrows, and as the two centaurs chase after her, they are defeated by Diana in usual unflinching manner. A well-timed headbutt and a tossed sword is all it takes to send them on their way. Hermes then limps out, badly wounded, and while Wonder Woman tends to him, he says Zola is pregnant. With a baby from Zeus. Yeah, the King of Olympus gets around. Genghis Khan, Wilt Chamberlain, Charlie Sheen, they got nothing on him. Issue number 2 starts on Mount Olympus with a rather distraught Hera looking in on Hermes and Wonder Woman through her vision pool, followed by a visit from one of her daughters, Attis, or referred to in this series as Strife. As Hera takes a seat on her throne, the two discuss how Zeus loves to commit adultery on her, which is very true. Tristan Thompson has been more faithful. After that, they peek in on Wonder Woman again, now in Themyscira, otherwise known as Paradise Island, where she has brought Zola and Hermes, but it is not long before they are surrounded by Amazons ready to pounce. However, things stay civil after Queen Hippolyta emerges to greet her daughter. The three are then brought to the Amazonian kingdom, where Diana tells her mother about the possible problem she's now involved with, getting in the middle of a power struggle between the gods. No big. Meanwhile, Zola tells Hermes about her erotic night with Zeus, who took the form of a trucker in order to seduce her. Much more simple than the white bull in order to kidnap Europa on Crete, but anyway. Hermes then tells Zola of Wonder Woman's origins, having been sculpted of clay by Hippolyta due to having a barren womb. His words, not mine. And thanks to the Greek gods, this baby was given life. The New 52 decided not to leave this alone, though. Just wait until issue number 3. Over in the gaming arena, Wonder Woman is challenged to a bowstaff event by a clearly envious Amazon named Alika, who promptly gets her ass kicked seconds before Hippolyta senses impending danger, which has arrived first in an unknown explosion. The Amazons rush into battle, one of whom gets an opening look at the danger, which is Strife, and by the time Wonder Woman hits the scene, other Amazons are killing each other blindly due to that particularly nasty goddess. Next scene, in giantess form, Strife declares her action self-defense, and when snagged by Wonder Woman's lasso of truth, she says that the visit is to see her sister. Which so happens to be Wonder Woman. Issue number 3 pretty much starts at the end, with Zola, Strife, Hermes, Wonder Woman, and many other Amazons taking part in funeral ceremonies for their recently lost sisters, while Hippolyta seems to know that things are only gonna get much worse. Jumping to the previous morning, Alika is talking with Sister Daphne, and here it's seen that calling Diana clay is their way of insulting her, which Strife, still lingering around, finds quite amusing. Strife then goes to speak with Wonder Woman and antagonize Hermes a bit until a major theme of this series is brought up by our titular hero, how the Greek gods wind up looking like children that have amassed some form of major power. Wonder Woman then demands that she be told why Strife called her a sister, and this brings Hippolyta over to tell us the true story. Although the why as to how the two met face to face is left out, our Amazonian queen admits that she had a legendary duel with the King of Olympus himself, and it concluded with her sleeping with Zeus in even further legendary manner, which by now you can guess what the result was. Diana is the daughter of Zeus. Whoa. She's not quite thrilled to hear all this, even more so when it's found out that other high-ranking Amazons knew about it because they wanted to protect her from Hera. They didn't want her going the Heracles way. All of these forthcomings send Diana into the jungle to let out some rage, and as night approaches, Alika is still seen talking nasty about technically their princess with Sister Demi, spurring her to then speak out during the Amazonian funeral, and I'm not totally sure what the crabs fighting here are supposed to represent aside from reenacting what all the ladies just did in fighting each other. So, moving along, while Alika continues to be a high-ranking member in the Wonder Woman Hate Club, her speech is halted by a fierce punch from Diana, and after using some, Wonder Breath, she ignites the final part of the funeral ritual before announcing that she is leaving, never to return as a sister of theirs, only a superhero. Issue number 4 takes things back to London with Diana partying in a nightclub alongside Hermes, Zola, and Strife, who pours her newly discovered sister a drink while offering advice regarding how incredibly disturbing and diabolical it can be as part of the Greek gods' pantheon. Things then become quickly jaded and bloody after it's mentioned by Hermes that both Diana and Zola are on Hera's hit list now, with Strife suggesting an unborn sacrifice be made, warranting a smashed champagne glass through the hand, which apparently offends her to the point of leaving. Other characters are getting introduced in the next two issues, so she had to go for a bit. Over on Paradise Island, a violent storm is hitting because of Hera, So Hippolyta tells an advisor named Dessa to relay a message of no offensive action to the rest of the Amazons. Hippolyta meets Hera face to face at first, trying to quell any hatred toward her, but then it looks like Hera was going to ask her a rather sad question. How can she get Zeus to love her? There's no chance to answer though when it's realized the Amazons have come to defend their queen, to which she responds with handing Hera a weapon and getting on her knees ready to ask forgiveness. But judging by Hera's next expression, that ain't happening. Quite unfortunate too, because Zola is seen reminding Diana that mothers aren't around forever, causing her to make a quick trade with Hermes for his special staff called the Caduceus in order to quick travel to Themyscira. Except when she arrives to try and work things out with Mom, only a clay statue of Hippolyta remains, surrounded by dozens of snakes that were once Amazons. Yikes. Lastly, there was a scene of Apollo in Darfur, Sudan, visiting with one of the best renditions of a Greek god this title offered, Ares, the god of war, courage, and spirit of battle. Apollo asks him if he'll be a friend or foe in the upcoming power struggle due to King Zeus being gone, but all Ares has to say is let the wars of man and god continue. He should just change his name to however you say thought-provoking in Greek. Issue number 5 kicks off in London again with two fishermen discovering the most grotesque seahorse you've ever seen, which will be seen again later in the issue. For now, things cut to the next morning with Diana, Zola, and Hermes having breakfast while discussing their next move against Hera, but then are interrupted by a gentleman named Lennox saying he knows Diana's secret. This character is great, well-witted but a tad smug in the more comical direction, and he is making himself known now because he's got knowledge about a possible Olympian power struggle on the way and wants to find out just how bad it's gonna get. Later on, when walking the Tower Bridge, Diana and Zola have varying opinions about Lennox along with all the things he claimed, one of them now being said that he is Diana's sibling. I like how they showed Lennox fighting in World War II in the following pages, establishing that he doesn't really age, and a little nod to Wonder Woman having been created in the middle of that conflict. Lennox is seen with Hermes having a bit of a passive-aggressive chat together outside of a big sewer pipe, and Lennox says he's going in so he can obtain a message. This seems like a good task for Hermes to join in on, but he claims to still be injured, more specifically the wings on his one foot, therefore he's useless. And don't ask me what can actually cause a fatality to these gods, they die when the writer needs them to, alright? Things first begin for Lennox with a long walk deep inside this drainage system. No Pennywise in sight, but he does get suddenly attacked by the Cerberus, a three-headed dog that guards the underworld, and that place in Greek myth is the domain of Hades, who makes his opening eerie appearance here next. Back to the bridge, Diana and Zola still chat right as more of those freaky seahorses rise up from the water below. So Wonder Woman gears up, jumping down to the aquatic creatures and announces herself to freshly surfaced Poseidon, the god of the sea, storms, destruction, and horses. Aha! His design was certainly the most out there thus far, but moving right along, Wonder Woman states that Hera is trying to take Olympus for herself, resulting in a tentacle attack on her. Where the hell is Hermes when you need someone to say, don't shoot the messenger? Things improve even less when it's also seen Hera has sent her two centaurs back to get Zola. Issue number 6 finishes up this volume. Wonder Woman is still trying to reason with Poseidon, and just as things are getting a little too hentai-ish, She realizes the two centaurs of Hera's are trying to kill Zola again, so her attention is diverted to them. Wonder Woman stuns one of the creatures for a moment in order to put the other one down for good seconds before it grabs Zola. And then she jumps off the bridge right before the remaining one can do anything else. Wonder Woman then also says that she hopes Lennox is having a better outcome in his endeavors. Well, let's see, shall we? He has told Hades about Hera's plan to rule Olympus, sparking the two to discuss how complex women can be. Trust me, Hades is not someone to dive into that subject with. Trust me. Anywho, Lennox has seemed to have made a proposition to Hades, who also gets a good chuckle out of him saying that he thinks he can quote-unquote run with Hermes. Big time foreshadowing. As the two emerge from wherever the hell they were, I couldn't help myself there, I'm sorry. It's seen a sort of meeting was set up, and that was Lennox's plan half executed by Wonder Woman. Hermes and Zola are present also, with things getting right to the point when the idea to share Hera between Hades and Poseidon is proposed. Obviously, Hera isn't having one bit of this, and since she's been pretty much spying on Wonder Woman non-stop with her vision pool, she appears in a huge lightning blast looking rather pissed. Now, this is when the second, more important part of the setup goes down. Lennox snatches a candle from this possibly Disney-inspired look for Hades. Guess the guy was pretty damn serious when he asked for a light earlier, and as he chucks it to Wonder Woman, Hermes tosses her Caduceus so she can teleport to Mount Olympus. Hera follows close behind, but she's too late in stopping Wonder Woman from throwing Hades' candle head thing into Hera's vision pool, rendering it useless. Why would doing that do what it did, and how was it known that's what it would do? I don't know, and I don't care. Wonder Woman then warns Hera that they are now enemies while teleporting back to everyone else. Poseidon is rather amused with these antics swimming off, however Hades, being the immovable type that he is, tricks Zola into a kidnapping and then states to Wonder Woman that he is to gain a new bride as in their proposal, or Zola's new permanent roommate will be Persephone. Alright, alright. The dialogue was top-notch. Of course, some of the titles got over 8 volumes, meaning there were hundreds of New 52 books out there, but as far as volume 1s go, this is one that could have been presented just in script form and still would have worked and been enjoyable to read. The gods speaking in riddles and half-truths, Lennox talking like the most English Englishman you've ever seen to grace the United Kingdom, somehow worked without inducing eye rolls, and Wonder Woman has so much going for her. Pragmatic and comforting, yet vulnerable and seeming to carry a big chip on her shoulder. Perfect setup to build up from in any direction. Gail Simone nailed Batgirl through her speech, but I'd confidently say that Wonder Woman was the top lady in the dialogue department. Looking at the art next, with a beginning glance you'd think it was rather simplistic in appearance, but it's actually a really sophisticated style if you ask me. Nothing looks weird or odd, the faces are expressive with minimum line work, and since many to most mythological figures aren't copyrighted in any way, anyone is welcome to use them and design them however they choose. For this opening volume, I was liking the designs of Apollo, Hera, and Ares, while kinda on the fence for Poseidon and Hades. That's just me. I also really liked Diana's long curly hair look here, gave off the George Perez art vibes. Wrapping things up with the plot, if you're a fan of Wonder Woman, you know many of her popular storylines involved her Greek goddess background, Rise of the Olympian, the Hikateia. They all involve that mythology, and through this event's entire 52-issue run for her, the Greek gods had something to do with the plot. This opening one definitely moved briskly, maybe a little too much at first, with Diana immediately taking Zola on after hardly no questions asked. But after this, things moved and meshed together so well. The constant thought of which characters from the Greek myths that might appear mixed in with the newcomers' high stakes and early consequences, it made it very hard to put this title down after you picked it up. That will do it all for today though, and if you've watched until the end here, I want to personally thank you for that, and to please like, share, and subscribe, please follow me on all my social media platforms, and to please join me next time for the Legion Lost Volume 1.